Earlier this week, US tech billionaire Elon Musk had a whack at the Australian government, calling its effort to tackle misinformation online, quote, fascist, unquote. The government's proposal would see companies fined up to 5% of their global revenue if they fail to stop the spread of misinformation. Here was the PM and other members of the government responding to Elon Musk's comment.
Prime Minister, what's your response to Elon Musk calling your government fascist?
Well, social media has a social responsibility. If Mr. Musk doesn't understand that, that says more about him than it does about my government.
Oh, this is crackpot stuff. This is about sovereignty. The Australian government, like every other democratic country in the world, asserts its rights to make laws to keep Australians safe. And this is not about free speech. How can anyone, in the name of free speech, defend criminals publishing misleading content online, which is leading Australians to lose billions of dollars? How can anybody, in the name of free speech, defend criminals posting child pornography online? How can anyone, in the name of free speech, defend having deep fakes posted online? How can anybody, in the name of free speech, defend the live streaming of a murder scene? This ain't free speech.
All right, well, joining me live on the program to discuss this and other matters is the Shadow Communications Minister, David Coleman. Thanks so much for your time, David Coleman.
Good morning.
Big week in your portfolio. Elon Musk is calling the government fascist. Let's start with these laws. The government insists this is about big tech and crazy ads saying Anthony Albanese says you should invest in something and so on. They say it won't harm traditional media or freedom of speech. Do you believe them?
No. I mean, look, the government got this wrong catastrophically last time, Andrew. So the minister put this bill out in June last year. We had 4 months when pretty much everyone in Australia came out and said it was a grotesque piece of legislation, from the Civil Liberties Council to the Human Rights Commission to more than 20,000 ordinary Australians who put in submission. So they pull the bill in disgrace in November. They then work on it for 10 months. And then they've come out with a bill which has a lot of issues. Now, it hasn't been to our shadow cabinet yet, and we'll go through our normal processes, but there's a lot of problems with this bill.
Do you think it'll ever see the light of day then? Could you see the crossbench supporting it? Because it sounds like you're not going to support it.
Well, look, I think if you look at the bill, I mean, so the minister's had 10 months, and she comes out in section 68 of this bill with a power to personally order misinformation investigations, for power to personally order public hearings into misinformation events. This is extraordinary in a democracy. I mean, in this bill, Andrew, if you're an academic, something you say basically can't be misinformation. But if you're an ordinary Australian who disagrees with an academic, it can be misinformation. And we in the coalition will always stand up for free speech. We did that last time. We fought this bill very hard. It had to be withdrawn. And we'll certainly fight hard for free speech this time as well.
I guess your issue is it threatens penalties for material that is, quote, verifiable as false, misleading or deceptive, unquote, and, quote, reasonably likely to cause or contribute to serious harm, end quote. That could capture a fair bit, I guess.
That's right. So it captures unintentionally misleading statements. And actually, in the explanatory memorandum of the bill, it expressly says it includes opinions. So it includes the opinions of Australians, and it doesn't have to be an opinion that's malicious or, you know, deliberately designed to harm people. It just has to be an opinion which, you know, does various things and is supposedly reasonably verifiable as false. And then it actually describes in the EM, you know, how do you work out if something's reasonably verifiably false? And it says, oh, you look at expert opinions. But, you know, experts aren't always 100% right. And so the notion that we would put these rules in place, I think, very, very, very difficult. One of the things in the bill, the kinds of harm that is not allowed, is something that might cause imminent harm to the economy or the stock market.
Yeah, I saw that.
And, I mean, that's basically every economic policy that the Greens have ever announced. So are we basically saying under the misinformation bill that, you know, effectively all Greens economic statements are misinformation? And, of course, a much better way, and as we always have in democracies, not forgetting we're one of the great democracies of the world, talk about stuff, debate ideas. If someone says something that's wrong, challenge it. win the debate.
Is there a way to do this, as far as you're concerned, in terms of big tech, though? Because, I mean, I take all your points seem pretty reasonable, but what about this rubbish that's just getting unloaded on the internet? Is there a way to come up with a misinformation bill or something similar that isn't this broad brush, that isn't this, I guess you would say, dangerous in terms of curtailing free speech?
Yeah, well, look, I mean, obviously the task ahead of us is to respond to what's put in front of us by the government. So we'll do that. We've said we'll do that in good faith. We will do it. We'll see where we get to on that. And obviously in relation to coalition policies, we'll have more to say on all areas of policy before the election. But the bill is on the table there's a lot of problems in it. I mean, you can also, ACMA can also require someone who works for a digital platform to produce documents related to misinformation. Contractors who work with digital platforms can be required to hand over documents. It is still very broad and there's a lot of issues with it.
What do you think of Elon Musk saying the Australian government's fascist?
Well, look, obviously I wouldn't use those words. I mean, I would say incompetent, grossly incompetent. I would say contemptuous of free speech. There's a lot of things you could say. I would say, more generally weak, indecisive and so on. But that's not a term that I would use.
From what you said before, will you be looking at some sort of a policy to crack down on big tech?
Oh, well, I think
going to the election.
I think in terms of big tech generally, there are heaps of issues, absolutely. And the
misinformation
point,
being one, though?
Well, as I said, we'll provide policies across all areas prior to the election. But I think with big tech, this idea that sometimes people say, oh, well, you know, they're overseas and they're big companies, so what can you do? That is completely wrong. If you want to operate in Australia, you're subject to the laws of Australia, and sovereignty resides with the people, not the tech platforms. And, you know, Peter Dutton took a very strong stand on social media age verification months ago, and we committed to doing that and putting in place an age of 16. Peter Dutton has a very strong record of taking on technology companies, and we've demonstrated that we would do that, but you've got to get the actual content right.
Just on that, I mean, that's something you and Peter Dutton have been talking about for a while, this social media ban. You want under 16. What do you think of the PM jumping on board last week?
Oh, look, welcome the fact that he's on board with the concept, because it is a hugely important concept, because the damage that's being done to our kids is immense, especially girls. If you look at the data on, it's a heavy topic, but things like self-harm by young girls, it's frightening. So welcome the fact that he's on board. The announcement itself is completely farcical, because he basically was, you know, we've been pushing for it. Premier Malinauskas, to his credit, has been pushing for it. So the PM's gone, geez, we better do something. We don't want to get behind on this. But on the day they announced they were going to do it, they've been saying that they need to do this age verification trial. They're working on the trial. They put out the tender for the trial on the same day they announced they were going to do it. And so this age verification trial, it's not going to start till late October. And
I think the PM said in the House something like they've done some trialling, this is another
trial. They've had some meetings. So basically they've described some other things they've done as a trial. They're not a trial. Trial's when you actually trial something.
OK, but let's talk about this. I mean, how workable is this? Would tech companies be required to check ages? Could it be done through technology? Do we even have the technology to do this? Could a youth put a mask over their face? Are you going to penalise parents, or are you going to penalise tech companies? How's it all going to work?
Yeah, sure. Well, first point is a tech company. So the obligation will be on tech companies. And as to can it work, yeah, absolutely it can. I mean, I think it's important to point out, well, because people will say, well, you know, couldn't someone potentially get around it in this circumstance, or won't people try and get around it? Yes, they will. They will try and get around it. But that's the case with basically every rule we have in society. We have speeding rules. Do people speed? Sometimes, yeah, they do. Mm. But we don't say we just won't have any speed limits. You know, we have a legal age of alcohol. People.
But
you know,
would it be a biometric facial?
There's a whole different range of ways you can do it. So first, what you do is you define a standard. So in the UK, Ofcom, which is their regulator there, has defined a standard for age assurance for pornography. There are different methodologies. It can be video selfies. There can be techniques used by the platforms themselves. And then basically the regulator says, yep, fair enough, you're complying with the standard or you're not. And if you're not, you get a fine. And I think a really important point on this, Andrew, that hasn't been reported much is Facebook does this already in some limited circumstances. And when they do it...
How?
So they do some of those methods, sort of internal analysis of people's content, video selfies, things like that. And they say when they've done it, it's been 96% effective. So the notion that they can't do it is wrong. They don't want to do it because it could be bad for their business model. But the question for the government is, well, I mean, where's the government at? Because the government says we're going to do this, but can't tell you the most fundamental point, which is, what's the age? How can you have an age verification policy if you don't even know what age
it is? And briefly, why have you gone for 16 rather than 15 or 14?
Basically because we think that the longer we can reasonably delay the exposure of kids to this horrible stuff, frankly, that's good. And if you look at the data, if you look at some of those mental health statistics and so on, they're particularly concerning up to those ages of sort of 14, 15, 16.
Wouldn't you be better off just banning smartphones for under 16s?
Well, look, that's not what we're proposing. We're a bit focused on social media. The biggest evil here is social media. And so the biggest, the focus on helping kids has to be on social media. What the social media companies try to do is confuse and muddy the waters by talking about a whole bunch of other stuff. Say, look over there, but we need to look at them because
right.
that's where
just,
the biggest
issue. Just briefly, a lot of bullying occurs on messaging services like Discord and WhatsApp and the like. Should they be subject to a ban too?
Yeah, well, basically already under the Online Safety Act, you can report that kind of bullying, and people do. They report it to the eSafety Commissioner, and the eSafety Commissioner can order its removal, and she does that quite often. There's a review of the Online Safety Act on at the moment that's meant to report next month, and it may well include more recommendations about that bullying sort of regime, and we'll look at those very sensibly when the government produces that report. But in terms of what's in the age verification rules, that's really a question for the government because they're saying they're going to do it.
The aged care reforms, was it the right call, getting Australians to pay more for their aged care?
Oh, look, we obviously have been in a conversation about this for some time. I think everyone acknowledges that reform of aged care was needed. We were very clear that any changes had to be grandfathered to not affect people who were already in the system. We were very clear that there needed to be investment in rural and regional aged care, and also that the system was made sustainable. I mean, it's the government's bill. It's the government who needs to really explain all the details, but we do acknowledge the need for change there.
And just finally, local government elections. Been a difficult time for the New South Wales Liberal Party, of which you're a part. Peter Dutton's opposed Mark Speakman's move to put two women on the management committee of the New South Wales Liberal Party. There's suspicion from the moderates that this is a right-wing takeover aimed at punishing them.
Oh, look, I think what this
is a difficult question for you. What do you make of all that?
Oh, I think that this is about making sure we're match fit and we run the very best possible federal election campaign because, you know, we need to beat this government. And to beat this government, we need to win seats in New South Wales.
But is having two Victorians who are in their 70s the best way to run a state party?
Oh, look, I think that the average person isn't super focused on the internal machinations of the Liberal Party head office. We just need to get... put our best foot forward. We've got Chris Stone back as the state director, who's very experienced, a great operator, and that's something really positive that's come out of this process. And we need to really focus all of our efforts on defeating the Albanese government, which is one of the worst governments we've ever seen.
Well, Chris Stone is an experienced operator, I agree. David Coleman, thanks so much for your time.
Thanks, Andrew.